The two main applications of thermodynamics are power generation and refrigeration. The devices we use to produce power are usually called engines, which operate on the thermodynamic cycle that we call power cycle, and the devices we use to obtain a refrigeration effect are called refrigerators, air conditioners, or heat pumps, which all operate on the thermodynamic cycle we call refrigeration cycle. If during the entirety of a cycle the working fluid is always in the gas phase, we call it a gas cycle. And if during part of the cycle the working fluid is liquid, we call it a vapor cycle. And by the way, remember what we defined towards the beginning of this course. Closed cycles are those where the working fluid returns to its initial state at the end of the cycle and is recirculated. In open cycles, the working fluid is renewed at the end of each cycle. We'll begin with gas power cycles, and today talk about the Brayton cycle, and in the next few 10-minute lectures, we'll cover the Otto cycle, diesel cycle, Stirling cycle, and Ericsson cycle. We already know that the thermal efficiency for all power cycles is equal to the net power over the heat transfer in, and this can be written as network over heat in, total or specific. And we also learned how to calculate efficiency for more specific cases, like the Carnot cycles. The Brayton cycle is the ideal cycle when using gas turbines. Its working fluid is air, but the combustion is achieved by combining the air with fuel. The general cycle consists of a compressor from state 1 to 2 that receives fresh air from the environment. After compression, there is a combustion chamber where the fuel comes in to create a fuel-air mixture. The process inside the combustion chamber is assumed to happen at a constant pressure. Of course, because of the combustion, we're going to have some combustion products at a higher temperature. We call this stage 3. Those high-pressure/high-temperature products will go into a turbine, and the turbine will exhaust the gases to the ambient. Just like we've seen multiple times before, the net work will be the difference between the work being output by the turbine minus the work that is required to operate the compressor, and we can also draw a connection between those two if the power output of the turbine is used to drive the compressor. As it is shown right now, if we draw a control volume, we can see that there is mass transfer across the control volume, which means this cycle is an open system. Of course, this would make our analysis of the system be a lot more complex than what we've been studying so far. Not only we would have the intricacies of open systems, but there is also a mixture happening at the combustion chamber. So more often than not, and even though this is typically how the Brayton cycles are operated, with air intake and exhaust gases, we usually analyze them as closed systems, with two heat exchangers for heat addition and heat rejection. In essence, the combustion chamber is replaced by a heat exchanger where heat is being added, obviously from the combustion process itself, still at a constant pressure, and then between 4 and 1, we have another heat exchanger, where we reject heat also at constant pressure. This is a reasonable representation of getting fresh and cold air at 1 from the air that we get at 4. It's obviously not the same, but like I said, a reasonable approximation that greatly simplifies our analysis. The idealized version of the Brayton cycle consists of isentropic compression between 1 and 2, constant pressure heat addition from 2 to 3, isentropic expansion from 3 to 4, and constant pressure heat rejection from 4 to 1. Of course, we can plot this in a TS diagram. We have constant pressure lines, just like the ones we drew from the HS diagram in the previous 8-minute lecture, link below, or the typical constant pressure lines of a TV diagram, in the superheated region, of course. And because there are two constant pressure processes in this cycle, with four stages, we only need to draw two constant pressure lines for this cycle, one high pressure for 2 and 3, and one low pressure for 4 and 1. So let's plot these here. From 1 to 2, we are going from low to high pressure, isentropically, so 2 should really be 2 sub S, and because from 2 to 3, we are adding heat at constant pressure, the temperature rises. Then, from 3 to 4, we go isentropically to the lower pressure, so 4S instead of just 4. And of course, from 4 to 1, we reject heat at the heat exchanger. Of course, we already know how to analyze all of these stages. We have all the tools for even calculating efficiencies. We can use the ideal gas law, and if we have pressures and temperatures, we also have tables to find enthalpies, or even use specific heats, constant or variable, to calculate those enthalpy values without the property tables. Remember that we studied each one of these steady-state devices, and a lot more, in the 3-lecture series, link below if you haven't watched those or need a refresher. So remember that for each heat exchanger, we have that the heat transfer over the mass flow rate is equal to the specific enthalpy out minus the specific enthalpy in. The Q dot term for the heat exchanger between 2 and 3 would be positive, since H3 is greater than H2, and the Q dot term for the heat exchanger between 4 and 1 would be negative, since H1 is less than H4. And this is consistent because we expect heat going in between 2 and 3 and heat going out between 4 and 1. And we can even write this, like I just mentioned, in terms of the specific heat, let's say average. The same analysis could be done for the work terms between 1 and 2 and 3 and 4. Remember that these come from energy conservation, neglecting kinetic and potential energy. And these are the general equations that hopefully you remember from our previous lectures, and that we would use to ultimately find the efficiency of the cycle. We use the general definition of efficiency with which we started this lecture to write H3 minus H4 plus H1 minus H2 over H3 minus H2. Of course, this equation is not for you to memorize it as the general equation for thermal efficiency for a Brayton cycle. Depending on how you number label the stages, the subscripts will change. I'm just showing you the general mathematical procedure to get an expression for efficiency based on specific enthalpy values or even specific heats and temperatures. The other tool we have to be able to find the pressure and temperature values we need to find enthalpies is what we learned about isentropic processes and the pressure and temperature relationships. Link to that section of that lecture in the description below. And since P2 and P3 are the same and P1 and P4 are the same, we can expand this to subscripts 3 and 4. This is what we would use assuming constant specific heats. If we're considering variable specific heats, meaning trying to use the table for more accurate calculations, we have that this pressure ratio, P2 over P1, is equal to the relative pressure at T2 over the relative pressure at T1, which again can be written in terms of 3 and 4. Again, if you don't remember this, go back to 2 lectures ago, link below, to get a quick refresher on the use of relative pressure for the exact analysis. Now, everything I showed here today is for the idealized Brayton cycles. This is because we are assuming isentropic compressors and turbines. In reality, we don't have isentropic compressors and turbines. We already studied the differences when covering isentropic efficiency in our previous lecture. So you can probably already picture what the TS diagram for the non-idealized Brayton cycle would look like. The process from 1 to 2 would be a curve to the right of 2S, just like the process from 3 to 4 would be a curve to the right of 4S. Definitely watch the isentropic efficiency lecture if you don't understand this. And remember that we have the isentropic efficiency equations for these. Now, this is the simplest schematic for this cycle. We'll learn more about other devices that make this system a more realistic one. One of them is a regenerator. A regenerator is basically a heat exchanger. In reality, the temperature at the exit of the turbine is still much higher than the exit temperature of the compressor. So the regenerator supplies the gas with some heat before going into the heat exchanger after leaving the compressor. This, of course, reduces the heat input required at the heat exchanger, which in turn increases the efficiency of the cycle. But more on that later. We'll also learn about reheaters and intercoolers. For now, let's look at a simple example where we briefly apply what we learned about today, and if you want to check out more complex examples on this topic, make sure to check out the links in the description of this video. A simple ideal Brayton cycle uses air as the working fluid and has a pressure ratio of 10. The air enters the compressor at 280 Kelvin and the turbine at 1100 Kelvin. Considering that specific heats vary with temperature, what is the specific work required to run the compressor? Remember to pause here to try to solve this problem yourself before watching the solution up next. The specific work in that the compressor needs is going to be equal to the change in enthalpy H2 minus H1, assuming state 1 is right before the compressor and state 2 right after passing through the compressor. Since we were given T1, we can go to the ideal gas property tables for air and look up T1 to find the specific enthalpy there, H1. Now for H2, remember that we are assuming an ideal Brayton cycle, which means that the compressing and expansion processes are going to be assumed isentropic. Therefore, we can also write down the relative pressure value PR1. The reason for wanting PR1 is that we were given the pressure ratio P3 to P1, or P2 to P1, and we know that this ratio is the same with the relative values PR2 and PR1. Therefore, we need PR1 to find PR2, and with it, the specific enthalpy at 2, H2. We substitute the values for the ratio and PR1 to find PR2, and from the tables, we interpolate between these two values to obtain H2. We substitute H1 and H2, and find that the specific work to run the compressor is 261 kilojoules per kilogram. If you want to watch more complex example problems on this topic being solved, make sure to check out the links in the description of this video. You'll find those and the other lectures of the Thermo course, as well as other engineering courses, there. Thanks for watching!